Welcome to Jeremy's IT Lab. This is a complete course for the CCNP ENCOR, Enterprise Core exam. In this lab, we will practice using debug commands. We've already used debugs in a few labs and will continue to do so throughout the course, but this lab will focus specifically on debugs. Before we get started, let's look at the IP addressing scheme. The R1-R2 connection is 192.168.12.0/24. The R1-R3 connection is 13.0/24. PC1 to R1 is 1.0/24, and PC2 to R1 is 2.0/24. As usual, the router IP addresses are their router number, so R1's addresses all end in .1, etc. PC1 and PC2 are both .10 of their networks. Let's get started with step 1. It says to debug process switched packets on R1 and send pings between R1, PC1, and PC2, which pings produce debug output. Then, it says to configure R1 so that it displays output for all ping messages and disable the debug afterwards. Okay, I'll go to the CLI of R1. Enable. To debug process switched packets, the command is debug IP packet. To confirm, you can use show debugging. Okay, let's try some pings. First, from R1, I'll ping PC1 and PC2. Since debug IP packet can produce a lot of output, I'll limit each ping to a single echo request. Okay, I'll ping PC1. Ping 192.168.1.10, repeat 1. Okay, this ping fails. Look at the debug output. It says, encapsulation failed. Why do you think that is? Why couldn't it encapsulate the packet in a frame? It's because R1 didn't know PC1's MAC address, so it had to use ARP, and that caused the ping to fail. However, the second should work. I'll do it again. Okay, there we go. Pinging from R1 to PC1 generates debug output. The first two messages are when R1 sends the ICMP echo request, and the last four are when R1 receives the ICMP echo reply from PC1. That's because, even though Ceph is enabled on R1, packets to and from R1 itself are process switched. R1 doesn't use Ceph. Next, let's ping PC2 from R1. I'll just change the IP address and send the ping. Once again, the first one fails due to ARP. I'll do it again, and as expected, R1 shows debug output. Now, what if PC1 and PC2 ping each other? Let's see, I'll go on PC1. The login is username Cisco and password Cisco. Let's ping PC2. Ping 192.168.2.10. Okay, the ping works. Because this is a Linux host, the ping will continue indefinitely. It doesn't stop after 5 echo requests like Cisco iOS. I'll leave the ping active and go back to the CLI of R1. Notice that there is no output. That's because R1 is using Ceph to forward the packets. You shouldn't do this on a real device, but I'll disable Ceph and let's see what happens. Conf-t. The command to disable Ceph is no IP Ceph. Okay, as soon as I disable Ceph, R1 starts showing debug messages, quite a lot of them. Let me go to the CLI of PC1 and disable that ping with Ctrl-C, and then return to R1 once again. So this much output is shown from just one PC, sending a ping every second. Debug IP packet shows a lot of output, so be careful with it. Now we are done with step 1, so I'll use end to return to privileged exec mode, and uall, that's short for undebug all, to disable the debug. Now I'll return to the lab notes for step 2. It says to enable a detailed debug of process-switched ICMP packets from PC1 to PC2 only, not PC2 to PC1 or any messages to or from R1. Then confirm with a ping between PC1 and PC2, and disable the debug afterward. Okay, I'll return to R1. To do this, I'll configure an ACL on R1, and then do debug IP packet detail using the ACL. Conf-t. I'll name it ACL101. IP access list extended 101. to display debug messages only for ICMP packets from PC1 to PC2, I'll configure the following entry. Permit ICMP host 192.168.1.10, that's PC1, host 192.168.2.10, that's PC2. And that's it. I'll use end to return to privileged exec mode. And now I'll enable the debug. Debug IP packet detail, and then the ACL number, 101. Let's test it out. If I ping PC1 from R1, there should be no output. Ping 192.168.1.10. As expected, no output. That's because the ACL only matches ICMP traffic from PC1 to PC2. Next, I will go on PC1 and ping PC2. R1 should display debug messages for the ICMP echo requests from PC1 to PC2, but not for the echo replies from PC2 to PC1. Ping 192.168.2.10. I'll leave it running for a few seconds, and then use Ctrl-C to stop it. Now let's go back to R1. Okay, we've got lots of new output. Notice that for all of these debug messages, the source is 192.168.1.10, PC1, and the destination is 192.168.2.10, PC2. No messages from PC2 to PC1 are shown. And the ICMP type is always 8 for echo request. There are no type 0 echo reply messages. Okay, that's all for step 2. I'll use undebug all to stop the debug. Okay, I'll return to the lab notes for step 3. It says to enable OSPF on R1, R2, and R3. R1 won't be able to reach a full adjacency with R2 or R3. We have to use debug commands only to troubleshoot and then fix the configurations. There are a couple more notes. It says to set debug conditions to limit debug output and only troubleshoot one connection at a time, R2, then R3. That makes sense. Limiting debug output makes it easier to focus on one problem at a time. It also says that debug IP OSPF adjacency alone won't be enough. So we'll have to use another debug command too. Okay, first let's enable OSPF on R1, R2, and R3. I'll go on R1 first. Conf T, router OSPF 1. I'll enable OSPF on all interfaces. Network 0.0.0.0, 255.255.255.255, area 0. End. Next, I'll go on the CLI of R2. Enable conf T, router OSPF 1. I'll use the same command. Network 0.0.0.0, 255.255.255.255, area 0. End. And finally, I'll go on the CLI of R3. Enable conf T, router OSPF 1. Network 0.0.0.0, 255.255.255.255, area 0. End. Okay, OSPF is enabled on the three routers. Let's check the status on R1. Show IP OSPF neighbor. Okay, we can see R2 here, not in the full state. No R3 though. Okay, let's debug the problem. First, I'll set a condition to only see output related to R2. R2 is connected to R1's G00 interface, so I'll use debug condition interface G00. Then, I'll debug OSPF adjacency issues with debug IP OSPF adjacency. Now we just have to wait for debug messages to appear, which doesn't take long. This is the problem I showed in the lecture video. Neighbor 192.168.12.2 has larger interface MTU. And above, you can see it says MTU 1550. By the way, this refers to the IP MTU, not the Ethernet MTU. OSPF doesn't check the Ethernet MTU, just the IP MTU. I'll go on R2 to return the IP MTU to the default setting. Conf T, interface G00. Let's check the config. Do show run interface G00. Okay, the command is MTU 1550. This command configures the Ethernet MTU, but I just said it doesn't matter if the Ethernet MTU doesn't match. So why is there a problem? Well, if you configure the Ethernet MTU, the IP MTU will automatically be adjusted to match it. Let me show you that. Do show IP interface G00. This command shows the IP MTU, and as you can see, it says MTU is 1550 bytes. Just to prove the point, I'll leave R2G00's Ethernet MTU at 1550, but adjust the IP MTU down to 1500 with IP MTU 1500. And just to refresh the connection, I'll shut and no-shut the interface. Now I'll return to R1 and see what happens. It might take some time for the adjacency to become full, so I'll pause the video now and skip ahead to when they reach the full state. Okay, I used show IP OSPF neighbor on R1, and as you can see, it is in the full state with R2. Okay, I'll end the debug with you all. And let's confirm. Show debugging. Okay, no debugs are activated, but the condition remains. Next, I want to debug the connection with R3 only, so I'll use undebug condition all to remove the condition. Now let's add a condition to only show messages related to the G01 interface, since that's connected to R3. Debug condition interface G01. Now I'll enable OSPF adjacency debugging again. Debug IP OSPF adjacency. However, even if I wait, there won't be any output. The problem between R1 and R3 is preventing them from even starting to form an adjacency, and that's why R3 doesn't appear in the output of show IP OSPF neighbor on R1. And there is no output for this debug. Let's see the available OSPF debug commands. Debug IP OSPF, and I'll use the question mark. Here is the one I want to use. Debug IP OSPF hello. I'll activate it. This shows information about hellos sent and received by R1. Because OSPF hello messages are sent fairly often, it doesn't take long to see output. And I'll use the question mark. Here is the one I want to use. Debug IP OSPF hello. I'll activate it. This shows information about hellos sent and received by R1. Because OSPF hello messages are sent fairly often, it doesn't take long to see output. I've got the information I need, so I'll stop the debug with you all. Here is the problem. Mismatched hello parameters from 192.168.13.3. And the message below shows the problem. Dead R44 C40. This means R3's dead timer is 44 seconds, but R1's is 40. Then hello R11 C10. So R3's hello timer is 11 seconds. That's the issue. These timers must match for them to become OSPF neighbors. I'll go on R3 and return it to the defaults. Enable conft interface G00. Let me check the config first. Do show run interface G00. As you can see, IP OSPF hello interval 11 is configured. So why do both the hello and dead timers not match R1? Well, if you configure the OSPF hello timer, the dead timer will automatically be adjusted to 4 times the hello timer. So I'll use no IP OSPF hello interval here on R3. That should return both the hello and dead timers to the defaults of 10 and 40 seconds. Now I'll return to R1. While I'm waiting for the adjacency to become full, I'll remove the debug condition, since that's part of the lab instructions too. Show debugging. As you can see, the G01 condition is still there. Undebug condition all. Okay, I'll double check. Show debugging. Okay, it has been removed. And also, notice that we got a syslog message saying that the adjacency with R3 is now full. Let's check. Show IP OSPF neighbor. Perfect. R1 now has a full adjacency with both R2 and R3. Okay, in this lab we use debugs to view packets that are process switched by R1 and also to troubleshoot some OSPF adjacency issues. Debugs are a very useful tool that we'll use throughout the course. That's all for this lab. I hope it was helpful. Thanks for watching. Before finishing this video, let me thank my JCNP level channel members. To become a member, please click the join button under the video. Thanks to Jonathan Makara, Velva Jacob, George Streeter, Funny Dart, Nasir Chowdhury, Devin Suku, Gustavo Biar, Gerard Baker, Marcel Lord, Pavel M., Mr. Erlison, Dragos Hirnea, Zakib Shah, Mayor Salman, Mazen Anderson, Vitaus194, Gina Lindley, Mark Jackson, Bold1C1U, Michael Carroll, Gerald Guillem, Gabriel Braga, Hector Hernandez, Mara Tuba, Roji Kuriakos, Arpad Konives, 5 Feet, Owad, Tricky Mickey 123456, Daniel Brown, Scott Thompson, Jose Alvarez, Kevin Hayes, Hussein Yavuz, Samuel Tavares, Roger Bratseth, Mustafa Irsoy, Nasser Zahar, Brian Grant, Alexandru Badic, Georgi Gemejev, Dibya Swain, Arlen Plagaria, Adelson Pereira, Farad69, Lucien Stoichitoyu, Madmark 50484, Sean Powell, Alexandru Stratan, Thiago Bicalho, Abdo Zizo, Piotr Kaimov, Abubakar Berry, Jeremy, you are really, really great, Kurt Nell, Preeti Dongave, Omid Farakesh, Steve Cox, and Joe Black. Sorry if I pronounced your name incorrectly, but thank you so much for your support. Thanks to you and my other supporters, I am able to make these videos and release them for free on YouTube, so I really appreciate the support. Another great way to support the channel is to like the video, leave a comment, subscribe, and most importantly, share this video with others. So if this video was helpful, I'd appreciate it if you did any of those. Thanks for watching. Thank you.